Okay, so let's talk about something important and relevant.
Let's talk something important. Your album. What's this all about?
What album?
Well, the name of the album is No Duh.
No Duh.
No Duh.
It's going to be about 14 songs. There's not 14, there'll be 13 and a half, because the last one might get cut off or something like that.
Who's the record label?
It's going to be on Petroleum
Products. Petroleum, okay.
And distributed through, you know, Systematic, I'm sure, and Semaphore in Europe. And we also, Petroleum is going to be licensed through another label in Germany called Megadisc, who license rough trade bands like Smiths and Wooden Tops.
Oh, that's cool. When's this going to happen?
Pretty soon, I hope.
What, probably middle to end of September should be out. Hopefully, that's about a month.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's shoot for the end.
Well, we're just like now seeing the light of day, and tomorrow, Jonathan Siegel's going to come down to the studio and do his tracks. He's going to do violin and organ.
Jonathan Siegel from Cameron.
Cameron on Beethoven. Let's clear that up now. Because, of course, there aren't many Jonathan Siegels. It's like he's the Joe Smith of rock.
Well, there was the bird.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that was the, you
know. Man, sure was.
The name droppers are standing there. And, of course, we're going to make a big sticker to put on the album. It's really big. Camper von Beethoven in big letters. Jonathan Siegel plays on this album. And we'll probably up the price by a dollar for that.
Or
know?
Two.
Or two. But yeah, that's it. And then Matt's going to go in and hopefully finish his stuff. And by Monday, all of the tracks should be done and we should be ready to mix down.
I still have two left to do.
I know, but we're going to get you in too, son.
So is this album going to make it to your second party?
We haven't even planned that yet.
To be consistent, we think it probably not having
it. Having a couple of them. Before the album comes out,
I'm probably going to go and get a bunch of Marty Robbins tapes from Salvation Army and just release it on an 8-track for the record release party.
But Dean Esper should have did with his album.
Yeah, his album.
Oh, sorry, Scott. Sorry, I forgot about that.
Could have released it by mail and on television.
His album.
K-Tel presents on 8-track.
Casewell.
So are you guys going to support this album coming up?
Well, the tour is going to, obviously, we want the album out before the tour, and the tour is going to help support that across the country. And then when we come back, we'll concentrate on really supporting it here.
It's probably because you know, the time we have to spend on the album, we've got as much studio time as we can eat, so it's pushed the album project back, but it's been well worth it because, you know, we're really sure and confident of the record. Yeah. And,
no reefer.
No reefer, man.
Yeah, right. We don't have any reefer.
So don't ask us, all right?
No.
Just say
we're
no.
Not gonna go on. We're not going to go
this
on.
This band's clean.
So
just say no.
Anyway.
Yeah, it's the big lie.
No, but once we come back from the tour, which will probably be end of November. Probably end of November, then we're gonna try not to play as many shows in San Jose as we've been playing. We've been saturating the area. We're gonna try to get out to like San Francisco and up north, probably try Washington.
We're gonna try and build a circuit and be able to play no more than once every 2 months in any given town, including San Jose probably.
But still keep it like a 5 to 6 shows a month.
That's cool. That's a good move.
And keep going as far south as Phoenix and as far north as Vancouver, because there's a great position in Vancouver.
Most of the bands in this area have so much potential, but they stay in one area. They don't really get out too many other places. Yeah. And
we'll do the Alaska thing too. The Eskimo Mamas.
Eskimo Mamas.
We are the Eskimo Mamas.
What's this Alaska thing?
For real? No, that's a inside joke. An Eskimo Mamas.
Somebody once thought that our name was Eskimo Mamas. It's like Frontier Wives, Eskimo Mamas. And they were serious about it.
Thanks, Alexis. I totally see the connection there. Yeah.
No, Frontier.
Eskimo Mamas. Eskimo Wives. I don't know.
I want to ask you this one, but can you guys afford to go on a tour? Do you think it'd be worth doing it?
We have to. Yeah, we're not going to put out a record and not support it. That's ridiculous. I mean, that's
a lot of people.
I mean, how many bands have put out records?
Matter and never say never. Put out records.
Years later, they've really sold almost none. They've gotten nowhere, and the band eventually disbands.
What's this listening? Well,
no, it's really a sad thing because there's a lot of bands that have intense potential and put out a lot of good material, but never get anywhere because they just don't work hard enough at it. Mm-hmm. And and the tour, I mean, we're making the money now. We're trying to save up the money for it, and we're getting a band vehicle for the whole thing. And we've cut all the corners so that we're gonna have absolutely the bare minimum for the tour. We're gonna have
one pair of socks, one pair of underwear.
And then you're gonna switch. Right?
We're not gonna drink.
Right?
That's right.
And we're gonna be sleeping on the road. We'll just be driving driving nonstop, playing a show, sleeping on the road,
doing
and going on.
Can bark in your shopping center. You
and there's a place, I never heard episode, there's a place that has an espresso machine that fits in your car lighter.
That's right.
So we can take espresso there on the road, man. It's only $20. It's really cool.
Good idea. That's what I need.
No, whether we have the money or not, we'll have to have the money. But
yeah, we'll be able to do it.
We'll be able to do it. It's just something that we have to do, and I think every band should do it that's serious about what they're doing.
Thank you. John F. Kennedy, ladies and gentlemen.
Someone shoot him!
The point is that there's certain things that we have to do. It's like, one, we have to put out a record, and that was our goal, and we just, like, pieced it together. We just, like...
Go, Scott, go! Yeah! And you know, as much as most of the people in the scene, or a lot of people in the scene, think that we're just because maybe that's how we appear on stage. Actually, we're very serious about what we're doing, and that's why we're setting these goals for ourselves.
Sure.
Time.
No, but it's like the album's a reality now, and we have to support the album, so we have to figure out any way we can to get out and do that.
Home on the prairie. A hardcore spirit through the veins of every man. Why does the circle against our request? If we can't live free, we will die where we stand. I wanna die like the frontier wild, with a heart coming through and a six gun nestled by my side. Souls are hounded by hell's only choir, and the weak are fuel for the flame building higher. We sweat a good heart to purge all desire. We will cling to our dreams as we spit in the fire. I want to die like the frontier wild, with a horse on the turn and the six gun that's by my side.
KFJC, and that was the Frontier Wives theme by the Frontier Wives off of their debut LP, and also heard an interview with the Frontier Wives, and we covered a bit about the Frontier Wives last week on this show for part one, and they played at the No Censorship show.
Yes, yeah, on October 28th. And they did a really nice job on stage, and I appreciate it very much. They were very willing to help us out, and they did, with flying colors.
And let me think here. Just some. Oh, we have a track up next by the Frontier Wives that they played at the No Censorship show.
Correct.
So let's hear that right now. This is KFJC.
Without any further ado, the Frontier Wives.
People dancing with me.
So that was the Frontier Wives on KFJC Love Planet, which was played at the No Censorship show at One Step Beyond.
The next band is the Endmen, and they were one of my favorite San Jose bands. I interviewed the band at Muzzy's Club on April 18, 1987 for issue 4. Vocalist Timothy Strout died with a self-inflicted gunshot wound at age 32 on December 4th, 1993. So Cell 9000 and I dedicate this segment of the Mayhem Show to Timothy.
Yes, if you want to find out more about this show happening that we're doing right now, go to Facebook, POW Zine, or the website, which is powmagazine.org. Or you can call the studio, 650-941-2500. And you can even talk to Dennis.
Yes, you can talk to me about this, or even email me at the website. I appreciate any comments and feedback.
And here's the Endmen, KFJC.
Well, finally, I've been chasing you guys down for 3 minutes.
Have you really?
Yeah. First, say something in the tape. Say your name so I can identify who you are.
Rick.
Boom. I'm Rick.
Boom. I'm Sheila. I'm the keyboard player.
Boom. Boom. Chop. Chris.
Okay, where are you guys off?
New Jersey.
Jersey?
Los Angeles.
Santa Cruz.
Around the block.
Really?
Yeah.
What about Mike?
Mike is from San Jose.
He's from San Jose. Santa Cruz.
Downtown.
Cruz.
The record's out.
How's it doing?
Doing very, very well locally.
Doing pretty good locally. Every time we go in the store, there's none left.
Yeah, every time we go in the diamond,
keeps buying them.
Every time we go in the diamond, they're already there.
All your moms keep buying them.
Tower. Just in Tower Records.
It's serving its purpose locally because
primarily that's why we put it out in the first place. Do you want to know if it was fun making it?
Was it fun making it?
Yes, it was great. I had a great time.
How long did it take you?
We did it 2 days. The recording took 2 days.
2 days?
Yeah. Just for the recording. And then the actual making of the record took a long time.
Oh, yeah. That's,
how long is a long time?
A month. Yeah, because there's the record jacket cover artwork that has to be completed. And then the actual sending of the reel-to-reel tape.
And those are real.
That's not hard, though. We've just never done it before. So.
Yeah, it was the first time for us.
It's easy.
First time for me ever recording.
Did you guys have a single out, or you never had a single out?
No, we had a lot of
demos.
Songs on demo tape.
Solo albums. Yeah, we had put out about 3 demos when we decided that it was time to put something out on vinyl. It's not as though as we were really ready to put anything out on vinyl. We just thought, well, it's about time we do it, you know, rather than just put out another demo. So, not to say that this material is the best. And the material now, it's really outdated because it's been, I mean, that stuff's been in the works for over 6 months, and we've only been together probably a little over a year.
Especially you guys are ready to do some new stuff.
Oh, yeah.
We're ready, yeah.
Who decided to pick the producer?
I did.
Okay?
Yeah.
How did we get
him? Yeah, he was recommended to us about a year ago, and we got ready to put out our first demo. Matt Wallace. At the time when we first hooked up with Matt, he'd done Faith No More and I don't know,
Yo
and stuff.
Yo,
and we were recommended to him. We went in and did some stuff, and we really liked him. He's really a nice guy.
Yeah.
He's really
fun to work with.
Willing to do experimental.
He's always creative. He gives us ideas.
And he's good if you're inexperienced. He doesn't, you know, he helps you out.
Yeah, sure. Besides that, and he did a couple demos for us, and in the last demo, or rather on the album, when we got ready to do the EP, we thought of him first. He's really good, and he told us that when we get ready to do an album or another EP, we're going to work with him again.
We'll be good in the month, huh? We're going to record tomorrow.
Uh-huh. So it's another album and a
work. We're going to go around and put some things down.
Not necessarily
to whether or not it'll come.
On vinyl.
Well, no, eventually we'll make it on vinyl. But we don't have any plans as to whether or not it's going to be an EP or an album or what. We're kind of sending some stuff out to some different labels and stuff right now. To see what happens. We just got one cool thing. We just got we just got a deal with a record company in Germany called Semaphore.
I think I've heard of it.
Yeah, and we just mailed over, we mailed the guy the stuff, and he really liked it, and he called us right away. So we mailed him 150 records, and he, last Friday, he should have had them by Tuesday, and he's going to, says that he can probably do something with it over there. He only handles American bands, and he's going to submit it to radio stations over there and to record stores. Yeah, here in America, like the labels that we've approached, we only approached about, you know, not that we're real good and organized about doing that kind of thing, but we've approached about 8 labels, and only 3 of them have responded, and then it was only to say that they, you know, basically thanks for mailing your stuff out, and it was good, but, you know, talk to you later. You
know? They get so much stuff, I guess.
Yeah.
Who writes all this?
He writes the words and we write the music.
What song is it? I can't remember right now. What song is it on the compilation album for the Lonnie Works?
100 Kills.
Okay, I heard Dean today. I don't know if you guys heard him.
Mm-hmm.
He said that song is better live, or the better song on an album than the one it's on your album. You guys agree?
It's on our own EP?
Yeah.
Okay, there isn't a version of it on the EP.
Oh, he's saying that the song is better than the rest of the album?
Better
the song
than
is better
EP?
Than what's on the EP?
Right, yeah.
That's probably true in a way.
Yeah, because some of our songs lost their appeal. Like, what is real on the EP doesn't sound nearly as good on the EP as it does live. Because we live, there's so much more energy, you know?
Yeah.
It's kind of a, you can feel the emotion in it then. Whereas it's hard to pick that up on an EP, you know?
And I kind of agree with you. Yeah. You can hear it, you know, live.
Yeah.
But I think not that many people know about that song, 100 Pills, and a lot of people know about songs on EP.
Yeah.
Especially one in particular.
Well, 100 Pills just got on the record, so...
Yeah.
There's no way they could have heard it before.
Yeah.
You guys like to put on a live song on the next show?
It sounds like a good idea.
Do you guys think that's better?
I think that whatever we record next is going to have more, we're going to try to get more of a live feel to it, you know, more of a rough feel to it. Because you hear us live, we don't sound nearly as polished as we do on the EP, you know?
Right.
We're not to say that, I know, it's like, and we don't really like that sound so much, I don't think, you know? The new stuff is so much different than what's on the EP. We're really starting to explore. Like, when we first started playing, we thought that we had to stay within particular, like, pop kind of underground formats, you know? We were always careful to be, like, on the right side of the wrong track, you know? But now we're, like, saying, we can do whatever we want, you know? There really aren't any rules. So we started to play around with, like drastic tempo changes and experimenting a little bit more with the car sound and stuff. Not that none of that shit has been done before, but it's new to us, you know? So it'll be way different.
Has fallen. I got a letter today. I got a
KFJC with Inside Out, played live at the No Censorship show at One Step Beyond, and their track before that, Letter from Constance, from their Shooting Down the Sun album, and began that bit with Endmen with an interview with the band, the Endmen.
Yeah, the next band, Gray Matter. Gray Matter was probably one of the most important bands for the No More Censorship Defense Fund show because of their growing popularity. But the relationship between Gray Matter and the club owner, Stan, was not good at the time because of the backstage incident with the band at the Lonnie Works record release show due to the long-winded event, making it a very long night indeed. I remember that show. But Gray Matter was more than willing to help us out with some conditions. I interviewed the band for issue 4 on June 6, 1987.
Here we go with Gray Matter, KFJC.
It has something to do with Wednesday. How did you feel about that show? Maybe
get that?
That?
Well, fart. Tell you the truth.
We didn't want to do it in the first place.
I'll start, you guys.
I'd like to go last.
I wanted to leave before the show was even over because it seemed like it was real unorganized, for one thing, and I knew we weren't going to get our allotted time. Which, you know, I wouldn't have cared if we only played a half hour, as long as we all got to play. We were only going to do like 2 songs each, right? It was going to be Gray Matter maybe doing 2 songs, Blended Down doing 2 songs, and then Gray London doing a couple songs, and that was going to be it. Every single band that played that night played for a long time, and then not only that, there was a lot of talking and sitting around in between songs that just, it took forever, man. It was just like this never-ending thing, and we're just watching people walk out the door,
it was really kind of frustrating, you know. And I thought it would have been a better statement than playing and showing ourselves in a bad light, getting a little bit frustrated and mad on stage. We should have just took off and left. Yeah. You know, I thought it would have been better if we would have just left and let Frontier Wives play, you know, another hour. You know, that would have been fine. Mm-hmm. That's how I feel about it. I think it would have been better just to leave.
Sean, what about you?
It went. That's what happened. I'm not used to a bitch about it now.
I couldn't really add much to Joe. I mean, it was really a drag. It was an unpleasurable experience all the way around. We didn't want to do it in the first place because we don't really like the club at all.
We really don't. We don't like that club.
So it has a lot to do with what happened a year ago. How did that start?
Maybe Mike got to explain that.
Yeah.
The initial risk.
Well, first of all, how do you feel about the last night, Joe?
Not proud by what happened, of what, you know, the way I have of myself. I felt almost betrayed by
every other band,
by the band, and well, by some, by, you know, these bands that we played with are not, you know, they're not newcomers to playing gigs.
Yeah.
You know, they're not newcomers to doing encores. They know that if they play longer, that somebody's going to get bumped later on. They know because they've been in that situation. Still, that is something that they abuse. I also feel very disappointed in the way this thing was organized.
By
whoever was supposed to be the stage manager, Dean or
Paul Gell.
If they were supposed to be managing the stage, they did a job. The stage manager often has to play, you know, the heavy and say, sorry, you know, you got to either cut your encore to one song or no encore or whatever.
Push the button.
They do. That's part of their job. And nobody gave a f-.
Yeah,
and everybody knew who was going to get it in the end. And nobody gave a f-.
But it seems like we always have. We've always, you know, if someone says, okay, make your set a 50-minute set and then include that in your encore, we do it, man. That's all there is to it. We have a lot of, you know, even if we don't like the band, we'll do it.
Because we don't want to screw anybody.
Yeah.
You know, we don't want anybody in the position that we ended up in.
Yeah.
Well, that kind of confuses me. Some of the bands that play that night are also part of First Strike.
Yeah, funny, isn't it?
And it's kind of ironic what happened that night.
Yeah, really.
How do you feel about that?
We were surprised, definitely.
We were really surprised.
Very surprised.
We were disappointed. All of us were disappointed.
Very disappointed.
Yeah. Really let down in a lot of ways, man. We thought they had more respect for us than that.
Only one of the band that played that night was First Strike.
Isn't that three first time?
No.
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 Oh, that's right. I guess just Frontier Wives, huh?
Frontier Wives.
Well, that's what I was. I should have said that. I didn't want to.
On that point, Scott Long has always been, got to get a crane and whip the guy off stage. He just loves being up there. But I mean, it wasn't as they were a contributing factor, but it had gone on throughout the night.
Yeah. They went on 45 minutes late.
So you figured everybody forgot about the time.
I think that everybody took advantage of the lack. Everyone took advantage of the lack of stage management. I think everybody pretty much had the idea.
Benefit.
Hey,
no one was getting paid, man.
Let's have fun.
You know, yeah, no one was getting paid, so they figured, well, you know, we have nothing to live up to here. We might as well just do whatever we want.
And when you've got seven bands, it all adds up.
Yeah, it sure does.
You know, and ran over 10 minutes late, and by the time you're on, you're 70 minutes late. You know.
Yep.
That's basically what happened.
Yeah.
Yeah.
15 minutes. Everything.
And 10 minutes to each individual band isn't going to seem like a whole lot of time, but when it comes down to the last half of the night, it's already piled up to being an hour.
Sure is. They didn't even need us, you know. I think we should have walked. I think we should have just forgot about it and left it behind us.
What about them? I waited until 1 o'clock.
Yeah.
It wasn't worth it.
And there,
it was not. I don't think it was. I don't agree with that at all.
Well, I was out there, you know.
What do you think? Do you think it was worth seeing that big cacophonous noise that was coming out? I don't either.
Was that the plan for the night?
No, it wasn't the plan, but that, you know, no one could foresee that. Obviously, if we could have foreseen what was going to go on, we would have all agreed, and we would have all left.
But I think Sean's point is, if there were four of your fans that have followed you, and it had stayed there throughout all the night just to see you guys, it would have been pretty to walk off and let them stay there all night to see you guys and not see us.
The ironic thing is they really didn't see us. Joe told me about some girl who walked up to a bouncer and at the front door and said that she was really upset because she didn't get to see Grey Matter, because she, in fact, did not.
I agree with the point, but what I'm saying is we did not know that at the time.
It has nothing at all to do with Grey Matters. This is strictly between me and Sean. And the result of it was that they imposed this sort of subtle blackballing of Grey Matter. They never made a statement that Grey Matter would not play here. And Grey Matter had been asked to play there a couple times on really shows, you know, this free benefit thing that we did on Wednesday. And we had heard that they were interested in us playing Fat Night. They never came to us with a national show. The only national show we got in, like, the past year was X, because KLME came in there and said, we're showcasing Grey Matter, you have to have them on this show. Mm. Basically what happened was, Grey Matter was the first live band to ever play at One Step Beyond. They were the very first band to ever play there. Sean had invested in the club before they started doing live music. He bought stock in the club. We went in there, I believe we did probably four shows, and then me and Sean, King Penguin Productions, which now is booking Muzzy, said, let's put on a couple of shows, bring in some national acts. And we worked with them on what we thought they needed for a stage and lights and all this. This was before they had any of that. And so they went and built it, whether it was our saying, build it 3 feet higher, or whatever. They went and built it. And they, you know, when they decided they were going to do live music, they got the setup they have now. We put on the first band to ever play that big stage as promoters, which was the Beat Farmers. And we paid the Beat Farmers, and what was supposed to happen was the club was supposed to give us 100% of the door. This was talked about up front, no problem at all. And basically we went on, put on the Beat Farmers, Grey Matter was on the bill, I believe probably the Whistling Bullets, or was it Big Hair or Country Wise, something?
It was right when Big Hair broke up.
Yeah, and they were on the bill, whatever it was. And the Beat Farmers played, the show broke even from a promoter standpoint. On the door, we broke even. And at the end of the night, they came up to us and said, oh, you know, we're just so used to just taking the door that we forgot that you guys got the door tonight, and we made a safe drop. We dropped all the money in the safe, and we can't get at it now. We're going to have to cut you a check. Well, in the same package, we booked the Beat Farmers. About 2 weeks later, we had booked the Uptones to play the big stage. Now, the Uptones came in, and the expense was, I don't know, over $2,000. And the Uptones show lost $700, and they did the same thing to us again. As promoters, having nothing to do with Grey Matter. Grey Matter didn't even play the show. As promoters, they came up to us at the end of the night and said, oh, yeah, we're so used to dropping the money, we just dropped your money in the safe again. We're going to have to cut you a check. And in those 2 weeks, they'd never gotten us the money from the Beat Farmers. So this debt they owed us added up to over $2,000. So at this time, they're saying, oh, it's just a matter of cutting you a check. We've got to put in the request for the check, this and that, and it'll be in 4 days. They strung us along on giving us a check for promoting those two shows for the $2,000, even though we lost $700. They strung us along for 2 to 3 months on that. Even though Sean was an investor in the club, we put on their first live fucking act. All they had to do was give us the door money. They told us what the door money was. You know, they kept saying, we'll cut you a check, we'll cut you a check. They kept doing it for 2-3 months. Finally, me and Sean went in there and went up to a bartender who's at the time was like, I don't know, head of that crew, who was a friend of ours. And we said, listen, give us some advice here. This is a really awkward position for us. Sean's an investor in the club, and yet if they don't give us our money, we're going to have to sue the club. You know, and we didn't have anything on paper, but it was all verbal, and it was fine, and a lot of this stuff is. And they said, the lady said to us, well, let me talk to Stan and see what I can do. The next day, when she went to Stan, obviously said, look, these guys are going to sue you if you don't give them their money. We got a check. After all this time, we went in and said, they gave us a check. So anyhow, up until that time, when they gave us the check, they were in love with us. They were in love with Grey Matter. Grey Matter had played there more than any other band. And it was like, just because of this Englishman, whatever, pompous bullshit attitude. How do you...
All the way from Prima. Grey Matter.
broadcasting from Foothill College. This is KFJC, Los Altos Hills. Yes. KFJC and Grey Matter playing live at the No Censorship show at One Stump Beyond, and that track was Blue Sky Way. And we heard an interview with Grey Matter and their track Save Your Tears is what started off that set from their album. It's 4:57 a.m.
Yeah, the last band on the No More Censorship Defense Fund is London Down, and it was another popular San Jose band which drew a large audience to many of their shows. I had no idea at the time I would be working with this band 2 years later. I interview London Down for issue 4 on August 1987.
So here's London Down in the final minutes wrapping up the Power Magazine special on KFJC.
I knew him because we both worked at Sears, Cupertino, and we used to get together on weekends and just jam and drink beer. You had like tons of, you know, 60s tunes we knew or whatever, just for fun. And it always clicked really fast. And, you know, we got played really well together. Then our bands broke up, and we were just kind of looking for a band. We got together and started playing parties and just gelled from there, started the parties, and we got into the pub and stayed and pitched the other places. Just kind of been building up from then on. Yeah.
It was never really any one particular person's idea, you know, it just kind of just happened, you know. We'd get tired of rehearsing with our bands, so Friday night, you know, we'd case a beer, and four guys or five guys, and we'd just jam, and we'd just develop from there.
So you can just tell we all got off, you know, together, and tell us some kind of chemistry there, where we had, like, you know, first time we jammed, we all did 20 songs together, you know, without even bringing anything up ahead of time, so.
Where did you get the name?
I was hoping that's kind of an English sound.
Well, it's got wheels on it.
So. Yeah, yeah. Douglas Quintet. Oh, Jesus.
Sounds a down or something.
Play the numbers, man.
And I was taken from a name of one of our songs that Steve wrote. And you can take it from there.
Take it.
When we started, I was thinking about this, what we could do to clean up this British. Looking for a name, couldn't think of anything. You wanted something that was ambiguous and didn't have an image. Like, you know, Huey Lewis and the News, you know, it's going to be straight ahead, good time rock type sounding name. So we had, we just like kicking around everything. I was like, London Down, it sounds kind of, you know, wavish or whatever. So, why not that? Then eventually we kind of like started, you know, we had kind of like a sound that was kind of twangy and people thought, oh yeah, they're English influence. It just happened. In the beginning, it was just like, we couldn't think of anything else. We had no idea what direction we were going to go into. We were just playing parties in. And we just took it from the song. Eventually, you know, it's turned into... The only drag is people think we're trying to be English guys, which, you know, like I said, when we started out, there was no intention at all. We didn't know where we were going, so we just wanted some ambiguous name that would fit any kind of band.
Something ambiguous that would, like, throw people, because we are from San Jose, and it's like, London Down, like, what? What's this? But the chemistry was right, because, like, Steve and Ken are brothers, and Phil and I have known each other since we were in the second grade. So it's like, Sears, like some sort of American, you know, let's do a TV movie.
Wow, let's quit, we're in a band, let's start our own department store, man.
Let's rock!
Steve and I used to pose in the men's catalog, you know, Sears thing, you know.
It's like for months, people used to say, yeah, you know, I was in a band, and I'm talking to Phil guy in the hardware department, he plays guitar, I'm like, yeah, everybody plays guitar, big deal. Yeah. Everybody at a bar, we started talking, it's like we both play the same guitars, like the same music, like, let's jam, man.
Steve never used to talk, you know. People would go, yeah. Oh, yeah, Steve down in, you know, does stock now for the shoe department. He plays guitar. I'm like, Steve who? I've never even seen the guy.
He works out of the store. Why do we talk to him? He let him upstairs.
It's funny walking past the guy in the corner back there and like, hey, how's it going, man? Yeah. Like, you know, Steve's like, you know, kind of smiling, you know, with like eight pairs of shoes on your back. Like,
hey, we had a bar found out how much we like to drink beer and had the same guitars. Like, gotta be a band.
So instead of shoes, it's guitars and money.
Guitars and beer and no money. And it all goes into records, man.
How'd you get outside of San Jose?
We did like San Francisco. We played the farm on a first strike thing. It was pretty horrible.
Oh, you did that? That place is pretty quiet.
Yeah, it's big, man. It's a good sound system.
A lot of the San Francisco bands love that place.
Yeah.
Because it's an intimate, you know, community-type place. You know.
It's real loose. I mean, you can go there, like, whatever you want. It's like a lot of it's more casual.
Are you going to support your album and like, tour or something like that?
Yeah, we're hopefully going to string some colleges, Northern California colleges, and, you know, the upper end, like Sacramento and, you know, Chico. And we hear there's a lot of good stuff down in Fresno. A social club, like this place, Wildwood Yonder, Whistling Bullets. And Whistling Bullets, I guess, is like the biggest thing in Fresno. They went down there and played Wild Blue Yonder, and they sold it out, and they had to go up to this like next bigger, you know, venue, and then they sold that out. They just said it was, you know, just fantastic down there.
It would probably start like over the summer with your record, promote it, you know, over the Bay Area. Yeah. And by next fall, maybe we can set up something, you know, colleges down south and north.
We've got to get some transportation. That's the thing that's holding us back right now. We don't know if we want to distribute the thing out, you know, like Nashville. We're talking to Scott Long and Petroleum Byproducts, and they have like, you know, a mailer of 300 stations, college stations. But we don't know if we, you know, should do that because we have no, you know, means to get there if the thing got hot.
Even at that, you can just get it outside of California. So
yeah.
Because I know social clubs do good in Vancouver. Yeah, Gray Matter's doing good in Cal Poly, San Luis Obispo. Well, you know, these bands are really doing it outside the area.
Are you still going to gig around the Bay Area, you know, San Francisco, Berkeley?
Yeah. Hopefully San Francisco. I'd like to be working at some of the clubs up there.
Yeah. So what's the most unusual experience that you guys had so far being together as a band?
As far as insane things that happened at a gig? Or
Where do you want to share?
I did this thing up at St. Mary's about a year ago, and it was all for these graduating seniors.
Yeah.
And, you know, dumb here. It's on the last
I am
song.
Dumb
on the last song, I forget, we were playing some like big college anthem, you know, as I like, requested it for like the last hour. It's like Twist and Shout, or Shout, or Shout and Twist, or whatever. And so we're playing this thing, and he invites, you know, he goes, hey, all the seniors, come on up here. But they're all seniors.
I completely forgot we're playing nothing but graduating seniors.
It's like crazy.
You know?
This portable stage, you know, just like, you know, this kind of stuff.
Been in the middle. We all bailed off.
They just all like jumped up. The effects went everywhere. And his guitar, I mean, he had, you know, like, you know, frat guys. And they're like, oh!
There are five people beating on drums.
Yeah. Like, there would be 5 or 10 people around Ken's drum set. Like all these, you know, girls after Ken, these guys. And he has his stick bag. They just grabbed all these sticks and they just surrounded him. They were just going, ah!
But yeah, somehow it kept on going. The song kept going. And after finally, you know, enough people left the stage, we scurried back up there and managed to plug ourselves back in and finish the song with the cats.
Okay, everybody's finished.
That was wild.
God, that was fun.
So one of the first gigs we ever had was at this place called, I don't know if I should say.
It's in Cowtown.
Hannah's Almaden Tavern. And we heard, you know, this place was like, you know, what is it, country or, you know, what the hell is this?
No,
so we go there to check it out. We're standing in the parking lot, and these two guys come out of the door, and they're just like flat out like Hell's Angels, and they just roar off, you know, on both sides of us, like, whoa, and we're just, you know, well, do we mean he just gave me
that? There was this lady in there, if you could call her that. I mean, she's like standing in front of the big stage with a beer gut, like a sleeve, the shirt and tattoos, like, here's more, like she's supposed to be some kind of chick, you know? Yeah.
Is this what groupies
with, you know, no front teeth or anything. It was pretty funny.
That's probably the two biggest.
Get out of there with their lives. That was amazing.
They paid us, no problem.
How did the show go? Did everybody like it?
The show went pretty well. There was this guy, I guess like the patriarch of the bar. His name was Numero Uno.
Yeah,
you know,
is that it?
And he was, you know, he was all drunk and he was all, you know, hey, set him up, you know, Budweiser, you know. So he just, he bought us about 5 rounds of drinks and we played, you know, we pulled some stuff out of the hat, like some blues songs and, you know, we got through with it, and we even had some people in the back yelling, you know, I can hear that stuff, you know. Any day, play some originals. And we played some originals, and then, you know, it was like,
go back to the blues.
Dollhouse, drummer on gone people.
KFJC, and I just did a set with London Down and wrapping up the Powell Magazine special, and that was Possession Obsession from the No Censorship show.
Actually, that was Chucky, Strange Phrases.
Oh, Chucky.
Yes.
Sorry. Chucky. We're going to end the show with Possession Obsession.
Yes. Boy, we went a long time, didn't we? Yes, two shows, and I really appreciate that.
And we're done.
Oh, my God. Terry, I mean, Cell 9000 really dwelled into the culture of Powell Magazine, and she really worked her cord off for the past several months, and I really appreciate that. And it definitely was an experience working with her for the past couple of months. And also, I just want to make a note here before we sign off. I want to dedicate the show to Powell Magazine photographer Debbie Roach Loswick, who passed away 1 year ago. Thanks for the great pictures.
Oh, didn't know that. So what's our last track again, Dennis?
That would be Possession Obsession, Tomorrow and Today from the No More Censorship Defense Fund show at One Step Beyond.
And I'd like to thank everyone for listening, and send us your comments on Facebook at Powzine or visit powmagazine.org. And thanks for listening. This has been the Powell Magazine Anthology Special on KFJC, and here's London Down.
Oh, my name is General Bogdan. And welcome to Powell Magazine and the No More Censorship Defense Fund.